And good morning, everyone. Welcome to This Day.
Good morning. Today is Thursday, April 4th, and it's a new national day today. It's National Vitamin C Day, but it is also National Burrito Day. And I couldn't forget that it was Burrito Day.
Yes, it is Burrito Day.
And we'll have some good info on both for you in just a bit.
All right, and today on our show, we have a couple of the old pros with us. They're talking about two productions that they're going to be putting on over the next week or two. So they'll tell you all about that. Robert's Rules is going to be having their meeting coming up, and I believe it is not this Saturday, next Saturday. It's usually the second Saturday of the month. And Joan Milliman will be here. Globe headlines and interview with the folks from Laguna Hills Lodge.
Excellent. All right, today's meeting, we have the third landscape committee meeting in the boardroom at 9:30. All right, I got to get through a lot of information for you today. So while vitamin C is widely recognized for warding off colds, the vitamin is also clinically proven to be a powerhouse in other areas of health too. For example, vitamin C may reduce blood pressure and potentially lower risk of heart disease. And those at risk of gout can lower that risk by increasing their intake of vitamin C. It is water soluble and found in many fruits and vegetables, including oranges, strawberries, kiwi fruit, bell peppers, broccoli, kale, and spinach. The recommended daily intake for vitamin C is 75 milligrams for women and 90 milligrams for men. Now, topically, vitamin C keeps skin healthy by protecting it from oxidative damage caused by daily exposure to light, heat, and pollution. The popularity of vitamin C topical products has risen dramatically. With the right product, adding vitamin C to your beauty regimen can brighten your skin, reduce inflammation, and promote healthy collagen production. Now, the research of Dr. Sheldon Pennell, founding scientist of SkinCeuticals, established the parameters for effective vitamin C antioxidant delivery to the skin, allowing SkinCeuticals to pioneer the emergence of skin of cosmeceuticals. So there you go. All right, on to National Burrito Day. So a burrito is a heavy tortilla wrapped around meat, cheese, tomato, rice, beans, vegetables, and sauces. And burritos can be filled with ground beef, shredded chicken, shredded beef, or shredded pork. Bean choices often include black, red, whole, or refried beans. Vegetables can be grilled or fresh. It has cumin, chili powder, oregano, and a variety of other flavors. Chimichangas are burritos that have been deep fried. The word burrito first appeared in the Dictionary of Mexicanisms in 1895. It is a term used in the, Guanajuato region and means little donkey in Spanish. The burrito was first introduced in the United States in 1930 at the El Cholo Spanish Cafe in Los Angeles. Now today you can find a variety of restaurants that are giving away free burritos today, and I have a coupon that you can see. You can just get that online, and that is at El Pollo Loco. But here we're going to have Ken give us a little history on the Mission Burrito. Ken.
Yeah, the Mission Burrito really came about in the Mission District of San Francisco, in which I think that area up there has wonderful Mexican food. But it's almost like a kitchen sink burrito, those big, huge burritos with sour cream and guacamole and rice and beans and cheese and meat and everything else in it. Very similar if you go to Chipotle and you ask for all those different ingredients to put in your burrito. But it's wonderful, and love burritos. I'm trying to decide where to go tonight. Chipotle, we go to El Pollo Loco a lot. There's a free one there. Rubio's has a special deal. I don't know. It's going to be a hard choice. All right. And I will get my vitamin C because I'll squeeze a little lime on it. So there you go. I'll be all set. All right. As far as our weather goes today, well, today and tomorrow are going to be very similar. A chance, 20% chance of light rain or drizzle into the area. This should not be much at all. But it is. Now it's in most of the forecasts that I've seen, which is good. But really, it's not going to be that much. We may get a little sunshine here, but it shouldn't be too much. And on Saturday, morning clouds and clearing, and then we're going to be ramping up the temperatures, as you can see, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and I think even into Wednesday. We could have a little offshore winds, very similar like we had last weekend. So we're going to be up in and around Orange County coming up really more on Monday and Tuesday, but close to 90 degrees. In some areas. So some nice weather, a little bit of drizzle. This is great. You know, kind of waters the lawn and all that. I'll probably can turn off the sprinklers coming up this weekend. Here we are around the area today. Everything you can see is really in the 60s. Big Bear, high of 50. Big Bear, by the way, coming up, I think on Monday, they're looking at like 70, 71 degrees, and they're a 20 degree jump. That's going to be incredible up there. Of course, Palm Springs, they're 79 today. They'll probably be around 95 or so coming up in just a couple days, or coming up on Sunday and Monday. So if you're going out there, keep that in mind. But today, really nice. I kind of like this. And as I said, this time of the year, to have a nice weekend, then maybe midweek, a little drizzle. Perfect. All right, we'll be back.
Hi, I'm Brian Rott, President and CEO of Cart Mart here in Laguna Woods. My family's been in the golf cart business since 1959, and we win our customers over with the simple belief of we treat you right. We are proud to be the authorized dealer for Club Car here in Orange County and your go-to source for the sales and service to other major brands. We're conveniently located on El Toro Road, just minutes from Laguna Woods. So come by and see for yourself why when doing business with Cart Mart, there's no reason to go anywhere else.
It's Easter. Diane's Hallmark can help you with everything you need for the season, from cards and plush toys for the grandkids, as well as cards and accessories. Diane's Hallmark can help you make this Easter a special time for everyone. Remember, Diane's Hallmark has a large selection of Christian books and gifts as well. Come in today and see what's new. Diane's Hallmark is located in the Walmart Shopping Center next to Hobby Lobby.
I'm Dr. Leif Loberg, and I want to welcome you to our brand new facility here in Laguna Woods. We've been serving the community since 2006, and we're super excited to bring you an awesome team of doctors, Dr. Jackson, Dr. Ossaturians, Dr. Vian, myself, here to serve you in our brand new state-of-the-art facility. Call us in the morning, and we'll get you in the same day, guaranteed.
Through my window, I see the first sunlight, and I feel the warm ocean breeze. I see the waves that lulled me all night. That's what my window brings me.
Look at this.
That view is $1 million.
It's amazing. We can look at these kinds of places within our budget.
You don't have a bad view from here anywhere you look.
It's all about the view. Sunday night is beach night. Sunday night at 8, only on HGTV.
Did you know that Charlie Brown has never been able to keep a kite in the air?
This is what you call a failure face.
The only thing wrong with Charlie Brown is his lack of confidence.
What a good man you are.
Welcome back. Today in studio, we have Sheila Bialka and Carol Shallon, who are here with the Old Pros, and they have two very exciting events that are coming up. Well, welcome, ladies.
Thank you.
All right. Nice to be here. Well, I'm glad to have you back, as always. Always so fun to hear about your fun things that are coming up. Mm. So why don't you start and tell us about what's happening next Thursday?
Okay, next Thursday, Clubhouse 7, My Baby, The Bullen Inheritance. Okay. It was originally a book that I found in our library, and I just absolutely fell in love with it. It's the story of two of Henry VIII's wives, the least known ones, Anne of Cleves and Catherine Howard. Plus, the third character is Jane Boleyn, who was the sister-in-law of Anne Boleyn and gave testimony against both Anne and her own husband, George. Mm. So you have this wonderful, there are conflicts and manipulations. It's such great theater, really.
Okay.
And I have been very fortunate to find three delightful actresses who just have become those parts. And it is I'm just tickled pink. I'm floating on a cloud.
Yeah,
I'm so happy
like,
about it.
Yeah. She's pretty high over here.
Yeah.
So let me just ask you, how do you take a book and make it into a play? Like, how do you adapt?
Very, very much difficult.
I would imagine it is. So how do you do that?
The book was over 500 pages.
Oh, boy.
And each one, it's a series of monologues by the various characters. Mm-hmm. So I have a dear friend who scanned in a bunch of the pages. I went through and tried to pick out those segments that advanced the story.
Okay.
And then I sat down with the scanned pages and started going through it and just tightening and tightening and tightening. And then our dear Gila Zolan is this expert who could take what I did and type it up for me,
okay,
so that we could put it into a script form. And that's how it came about. Then we had the auditions. 10 delightful ladies showed up for the auditions. And out of that, these three who had the embodiment of the voices of those three characters,
okay,
came to.
And what do you hope the audience gets out of it?
It's exciting. It's entertainment. There's comedy in it. I can't repeat some of the dialogue because they're talking about Henry VIII and what they think about him. And some of it's not too flattering.
Like girl talk. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
But it's a lot of fun. It's a wonderful slice of history as well. And it's... Well, we were there for the dress rehearsal yesterday, and I'm just sitting there saying, oh, it's wonderful. And I hope that everybody else
it
feels
flows.
Like
it
I
really
do.
It flows really well, really
nice.
Well.
Nice. Yeah. Well, congratulations.
Yeah. And it's not just sitting and reading. I've staged it so they're moving around.
Oh, good.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was way too important to let this, and especially because of the length. So there's that visual interest that Sheila brought
right.
to it.
Yeah. Right, okay.
Yeah, you can't have people just sitting reading. It's boring, especially with, it's an hour, almost an hour and a half.
Oh, yeah.
The show is.
Yeah. Are they in costume?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
And do you have set and stuff too, or not really?
No, we can't do
that. Suggestion. I will say this, the fourth character is the crown. That everybody is after.
We've got a beautiful crown.
We've got a nice crown
that we borrowed.
Did you borrowed? Borrowed from who? Who has the crown? I'm afraid to ask.
I've got my connections.
Yeah, I bet you do. I bet you do.
It came from somebody's mother-in-law.
Oh, there you go. All right. Okay, well, we'll touch base on that one in just a little bit. Now, let's talk about what you have
okay,
coming up.
I'm here to talk about Charlie Brown mm-hmm. and the old pros. Now, our birthday is coming up next month. Mm-hmm. We're 15 years old next month.
Wow.
So I just wanted to mention, we started out with Death of a Salesman. That was our first play.
Uh-huh.
And then we've done radio shows. We've done Mousetrap. We've done Shakespeare on the Patio. We've done Blithe Spirit. We did Driving Miss Daisy when mm-hmm. Barbara Rush was here.
Okay.
She did Driving Miss Daisy for us. We raised a lot of money for the foundation on that.
Great.
So, and Arsenic and Old Lace, we've done such a variety. Mm-hmm. But now, we're putting our toe in the water and we're doing a musical.
Mm-hmm.
You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. This is a book musical. Mm-hmm. Neither the other group nor us have ever done a book musical.
Oh,
this is our first soiree.
Yeah, it's always been a pastiche of dance numbers and songs and maybe a little thread going through, but this is an actual plotted out from beginning to end story.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
right.
And we've got a good cast and some new people who haven't had that much experience on the stage, but by the time we've whipped them into shape.
And they're singing.
They're singing.
And they're singing.
A lot of singing.
Right.
A lot of
right.
singing. And, you know, Sharon is the conductor and she is wonderful with chorale. Oh, she's fabulous.
Oh, that's
without
great.
Her, we couldn't have done it. Because they're quite tricky, these songs.
Yeah.
And because it's not a very familiar show. To like if we were doing Pajama Game, everybody can sing, Hey There, You With The Stars, and you're, you know, all those songs are familiar. They come in, the cast comes in, they don't know these songs, so they have to learn them from scratch.
Right.
And they're not easy songs. You
they're
know,
not.
South Pacific, you,
well,
they flow,
too,
but
right?
you yeah. talk like Sondheim, and this mm-hmm. is... similar to Sondheim, you have to have the background.
You've got to
which
go
Sharon
right from
does.
The beginning.
Right,
yeah, yeah.
Right,
so,
right.
so we're really pleased about it, and I hope people will come out and support us because it's the most expensive show we've ever done. You
oh,
know,
why is that?
Normally a play goes from like 7,000 to 9,000 to produce.
Wow.
Yeah, a lot of money. But this is going to run us about $12,000.
Because where's most
the
of
rights,
the cost comes
from? You know, you have to pay a lot for the rights.
You guys did mention that before.
Yeah, then it's very stringent what you can do. You can't break the contract by adding characters and stuff like that. Oh, no. No, they're very stringent. So we have to tread very carefully. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of a trial, isn't it? Trial and error now with this.
Right.
But we are pleased, and we've done this little commercial that I think they showed up today. And we did it at the children's playground up at the church.
Oh, I did see the picture of that. That is so funny. Yeah. I mean, at least you guys, you have a lot of creativity.
Yeah.
And, you know, what do you think is your most challenging, you know, aspect to this particular play?
To this one? I would say the singing.
Okay.
I would say definitely the singing, because, like I say, it's not that familiar. Once you hear it, you say, oh, yeah, I remember that. But it's not the sort of, you know, there is nothing like a day. I mean...
Right.
It's not that kind of song. It's not that kind of show.
Right.
But this is a wonderful way for us to recapture not just our youth, but our childhood.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody has to think child, you know.
Right.
And if we stagger a little bit, that's fine as we go across the stage, because children do, you know? They're not very steady on their legs.
Well, that'd be all right. You just sort of, exactly.
We're going the
if
full
you fall,
circle.
It doesn't matter, right?
I'm doing a little of the choreography, and I threw in a skip, and they all look at me. We don't skip.
We can't skip.
But even if you try to skip, it'll still look good, right?
Yeah.
All right, so let's take a look at your flyer again and recap when that's going to be. That's next Thursday?
Yes, next Thursday, April 11th at Clubhouse 7.
All right. The
show goes up at 4 p.m.
All right, perfect. And it's free to members and $3 for guests?
Correct.
All right, great. And then let's recap
we are
again.
In May, so you've got a couple of weeks to get your tickets.
Okay. Well, and I'm sure you'll be on again, and we'll talk about it again.
Yeah.
So you're a good man, Charlie Brown, and that'll be in May 17th, 18th,
yeah,
and 19th.
That's right.
We'll go over
the
that
tickets
one more
time. Are on sale now.
They are now.
Yeah, they really are.
Okay,
and
perfect.
Please pick up our flyers, because we think our flyers are wonderful.
They're very colorful.
Yes.
I like it. All right, ladies. Well, congratulations.
Thank you,
Lisa. We'll look forward to hearing about it.
Thank you, my dear.
All right. And remember, when you sign up for these and you go to them, they go to good causes. So don't forget to go see, how you pronounce it again?
The Boleyn Inheritance.
The Boleyn Inheritance, and you're a good man, Charlie.
Think Anne Boleyn. Everybody
Anne Boleyn.
Knows Anne Boleyn.
Yeah. All right, we'll be right back after this.
And now's the time you've been waiting for. The undisputed champs, Tundra and Tacoma! And in this corner, the reigning rulers of the road! Let's get ready for spring!
Not bad.
Ready for a great deal?
Let's do it!
So good.
What makes an amazing deal even better? How about that every new Toyota comes with Toyota Care, a 2-year or 25,000-mile no-cost maintenance plan and roadside assistance?
Ready, set, go get your Toyota today!
Toyota, let's go places.
Are you looking for a better way to manage your medication? MedBox by AmeriPharma has redefined the pharmacy experience. No more pill organizers and vials. When we fill your prescriptions, you get all your medications conveniently packaged by the dose and delivered to your door at no additional cost. This means no change in insurance, copays, or out-of-pocket expenses. Call our specialists today and discover the new way of pharmacy. MedBox by AmeriPharma.
Welcome back. I have Erica Ritchie here, who's going to give us the Globe headlines. Some good stuff today.
Yep, as always.
As always. So what do we got?
Okay, one thing that's very exciting is the 16th annual Village Games are coming to Laguna Woods Village.
Right.
And that means that the senior athletes will be participating in 22 events. The games start on Monday, April 29th.
Mm-hmm.
And the activities include volleyball, badminton, basketball, bicycle, billiards, bridge, equestrian, golf, bowling, paddle tennis, pickleball, and some other outdoor events in the pool.
Yeah, and tennis and also ping pong.
Oh, yeah, tennis
and
ping pong.
Did you say ping pong? I don't know if you said
no,
ping
pong. No, I think I missed that one.
Yeah, but they're all very serious about all of them.
They are very serious. They're very serious. I remember I covered some of these games, actually, when I covered this area, and there was one athlete, Woody Bowersock, who won probably 8 gold medals over the when he was 95 or 96 years old.
Yeah.
It was amazing. Wow. Last year, there were 9 athletes over the age of 90 who participated.
That's
so
great.
This is a fun, awesome event for people to be inspired by and see what you can do, you know, when you're a senior and not be limited by your age and
mm-hmm.
compete.
Mm-hmm.
So that is something awesome that the community can look forward to.
Excellent.
And then in other news, we've got the drop-in lounge is going to be back on Village Television. I guess they approved yesterday at the Golden Rain Foundation, they approved a new 45-inch LED smart television that will be installed, and that will bring the opportunity back to the program. And then on Tuesday's GRF meeting, they passed a resolution that temporarily closes the Department of Recreation and Special Events facilities for staff training from 1 to 4 p.m. on Wednesday, August the 14th.
Okay.
So that is something that the community should be aware of.
Mm-hmm.
Then also, this is always a good thing, is if you've got electronics lying around your house, clutter adding up, the Village is hosting a goods exchange and e-waste recycling drop-off event, and that's going to be Saturday, April the 27th. And it's going to be held from 8:30 until 12:30 p.m. And that will be held at City Hall, 24264 El Toro Road. So people should definitely take advantage of that as a good way to get rid of their appliances, things lying around. There's also clothing, dishes, and furniture can also be dropped off at this event.
That's great. And then they said that Goodwill Industries will be on site?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, good.
That so that's always a good way to clear out your old things that
well,
you have living
spring,
around.
Right? Spring cleaning.
Right.
Perfect.
Right. Spring cleaning.
I think I need to do that.
Yeah, me too. And then on April 24th, the Garden Club is hosting its annual show at Clubhouse One, and that goes from noon until 4 p.m. So
oh, okay.
that will be another another very interesting event that residents can look forward to.
Okay.
Then in other news, back on the marine mammal front, last week, I reported on a ruling that was an agreement between the California Department of Fish and Wildlife, a nonprofit out of Phoenix area, the Center for Biological Diversity. And they came to an agreement that is going to be precedent-setting, really, nationwide. And a lot of the environmentalists are watching what they did. But basically, they shut down the Dungeness crab fishery 3 months early.
Okay.
So, and the reason for that is the gray whale migration. We've talked about that in the past. The gray whales are now heading north again toward their feeding grounds in the Bering Sea. And so in Sonoma County area, there have been an high incident of whales becoming entangled in fishing gear.
Okay.
A lot of the fishing gear is unmarked, but some of the gear that is marked has been found to be part of what the California Dungeness crab fishing fleet uses.
Mm.
And so because of that, this Center for Biological Diversity has targeted that fishery specifically with a lawsuit. This has been 2 years now in litigation. And so last week they came to the agreement that the fishing will be stopped early as a way to try to prevent the entanglements of whales and sea turtles.
Wow.
So that's good news.
Yeah, that
for
is.
People. That's
it's
very
not so good for crab cake lovers.
Right. Though. Well, and that you bring up a good point. So for crab cake lovers, that means that crab meat will not be readily available. For example, Gelson's Market, which is a market that serves our area, has told me last week that they expect that this will raise the prices.
Mm.
And it will also mean that there will be less crab meat available in markets such as Gelson's that are interested in selling locally produced food, i.e. in this case, the California Dungeness crab fishery, now is going to have to look to the Northwest, Oregon, and Washington, where the fisheries will still be operating and potentially get their crabs from there,
mm-hmm.
which is not something they like because they like to have the you know, produce or food produced here in California.
Gotcha. Okay.
So, yeah, but otherwise, that's very good news, and the Center for Biological Diversity is hopeful that this agreement, you know, kind of keeping an eye on what's going on with the whales, stopping the fishing early, and then the following years, the Department of Fish and Wildlife is going to watch what is happening if, for example, officials from NOAA notice that there are more whales in certain areas, then the fishery could potentially be stopped again on April the 1st compared to July. So it impacts the fishermen who've obviously planned and set up gear and maybe purchased boats and gotten new, more staff, deckhands to be ready for a longer season. They're impacted as well. So it's got a lot of potential effects, good and bad, for people.
Right. Okay.
And then in other news, the Tabernacle Experience. So this is basically a shrine that was created by a woman. Her name is Jeannie Whitaker. And she is the founder of the Tabernacle Experience. She built this 20 years ago. And it's basically a shrine that follows the teaching of Moses from the Bible. Okay. And it's got seven stations that people can go and go inside and visit. It's a very emotional experience. People from all over the world have come to the places that it has stopped at. In 2012, it was at Saddleback Church, and people were in lines for 3 hours to get in there. Now it's at Capo Beach Church in Dana Point. It opened on Friday and will be there until April the 11th. And people can go online and make reservations. If you go to tabernacleexperience.com, you can click and make your reservation for the day that you want to visit. Mm-hmm. It's open from 11 a.m. until 7 p.m. every day except for Mondays.
Where does she get those relics from?
She actually, it's an interesting you ask that. She, so when they came up with this idea to build it, and I'll have to tell you kind of how she came up with that real quick too. But when they came up with the idea, they basically had craftsmen from Dana Point, artists from Laguna Beach, that came together and they built this entire shrine. It's amazing. It's very, very spiritual and moving. And the neat thing about this is it's very, interesting to people of all denominations.
Right.
So it's not just specifically, you know, one religion. So when it travels around the country, any house of worship can request it to stop by, and then it does. But the inspiration for it came when she visited Israel. And she was at a site, and she felt that she wanted, she called out to God, and she said, you know, let me hear from you. And she felt her name being called, Jeannie, you know, this is what I want you to do. And then there was kind of a pause, and she kept wondering, you know, spiritually, what was in that pause? What did he want her to do? And so a few years later, when she was teaching Bible study at Capo Beach Church in Dana Point, she had the final message come through, and he said, you know, build me a tabernacle. And so that's when she built it. So 20 years ago, about 21 years ago, they began building it. It started going on tour nationwide 20 years ago, and her visit to Israel was 23 years ago. Mm. So it's all been this long process, and she estimates that by the end of this year, it will have traveled to 100 locations.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
That sounds really cool.
Yeah, it's really, really neat.
Oh, great.
And so then, yeah, so that's something, you know, if you're interested in that, you know, anyone can, as I say, sign up for that and go, and it will be there till April the 11th.
All right.
And then to our favorite segment, which is always the letters.
The letters.
Letters to the editor, and to make sure that I get them right, I will put on my glasses. And so this week's topics include praise for village gardeners, a plea to preserve water by not washing your car in the driveway, and outdated restrooms in the clubhouse. And then there was a letter from Shell Theodore, and she writes this. Page 15 of March 28th Globe featured a lovely photo entitled Like a Painting. Since there are many talented photographers living in Laguna Woods Village, perhaps the Globe could make this a regular feature, with subscribers sending in area landscape photos. A contest at the end of the year would have readers vote on their favorites.
That's
something neat.
Are you guys going to do it? Maybe,
well,
huh?
I think we should. I'll certainly put in a good word for it.
All right.
Yeah, it'll be kind of like our own Instagram on the globe,
idea.
Right?
If you don't have Instagram now, you have a page.
An opportunity. Right? You have a page to, yeah, to post your photos.
That's
yeah.
perfect. All right. Yeah. Well, thank you so much. Yeah. That's excellent.
Yes.
We look forward to seeing you next week.
All right. Thank you. Look forward to seeing you.
And remember, you could always get your copy of the Globe on the first floor of the Community Services Building on Thursday morning at 8 a.m. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm John Bowser Bauman. You probably know me best as Bowser from Sha Na Na, but I'm also president of Social Security Works PAC. And you know, when I'm in Laguna Woods, I always watch Village Television. Grease for peace.
Welcome back. Well, coming up, not this Saturday, but a week from this Saturday, the Roberts Rules Study Club will be having their meeting. And of course, Joan Milliman is here. Always good to see you. And today, the topic is going to be the use and duties of committees.
Committees,
yes.
Right.
Welcome. Good
Thank
to have you,
Ken.
Here today.
Nice to see you.
And let's kind of go in to talk about, you're going to read this and then kind of decipher it, okay?
Right. I overheard a conversation on the telephone. So it went something like this. Good morning. Have you heard the report which the chairman of our committee intends to make? You haven't? I wondered why he doesn't call a committee meeting. I think I'll telephone the others and find out what they think. Perhaps we can decide on something and have a report ready to submit at the club meeting in case we do not agree with what the chairman says. What's
okay.
wrong with this?
I'm not sure, to be honest with you.
Well, first of all, we have an individual committee member talking to another committee member mm-hmm. and trying to make decisions over the phone that for the whole committee,
right.
which you can't do. The chairman is supposed to make the report, but they don't. They don't put the report together. So if this chairman, they aren't supposed to work alone. The chair's not supposed to work alone.
Right.
If the board or the assembly wanted someone to work alone, they'd say they'd point a committee of one. But they don't do that.
Okay.
So the chair can't present a report unless the whole committee has agreed on it.
Okay.
So that's part of the problem. And if he or she can't or won't call a committee meeting, two members of the committee can call a meeting.
Okay.
So they get their work done.
Okay.
In our case, committees are appointed usually by the chairman of the board,
mm-hmm.
but even the chairman of a committee, if they need a subcommittee, will suggest this.
Okay.
The bylaws may indicate exactly how that's done. Or not, and mm-hmm. otherwise the chair usually names the people on the committee. The committee itself will elect a chairman, and if they don't, the first member named is the chair until they elect someone.
Okay. So the committee themselves can elect the chair?
Yes.
Okay,
and
right.
we do actually, okay. in here in our boards, the committees are appointed, and the main committees, the board chairman will select the committee and will select the chairs, and the chairs select the committees.
Okay.
In conjunction with the board chair. Does this sound confusing?
Yeah, a little bit.
It's just the chair has everything to say about who's going to serve on what committee.
Okay.
Okay. And when a committee is appointed, they are supposed to go into action immediately. You know, if the chair wishes, the selection of the committee should be right then, right away, when there's a motion to make a committee. Suppose you need a committee to plan a party,
mm-hmm.
we'll say.
Yeah.
And that committee needs to be made within that meeting, not after it's done, but then.
Okay.
Unless there's special permission granted sometimes. So committees are always an odd number so that there's a majority, you know, 5, 7, 9. If it's a controversial subject, you want both sides represented so that it can be thoroughly mm-hmm. discussed. If it's an action, if they're carrying out some kind of an order, like as I say, planning a party or mm-hmm. You should have supporters for the job, otherwise you won't have anybody to do
yeah.
the work.
Yeah, that's very true.
Who notifies the committee? Well, usually the secretary of the board will put everything in writing as to what happened and who's on the committee and give it to the chairman of the committee.
Okay.
And if there is, as I said, if the chair is not made, appointed, the first member named becomes the acting chair until they elect
okay.
somebody. This is probably more information than you wanted on committees, but Robert's Rules really sketches it out because committees can do things that the boards can't do.
Mm-hmm.
They're the workhorses.
That's true, yeah.
They're the workhorses. As far as organizing the committee, the chair usually does that. They call the meeting, and if they neglect to call the meeting, as I said, two members of the committee can do so because
mm-hmm.
they have a certain time limit, usually, to do their action, whatever it might be.
Right.
Standing committees usually take reports and report back to the board what they found, and
mm-hmm.
usually they're not working on problems, but they have to have a reporting made. So
okay.
that's a little different. But what can a committee do? Well, they can discuss informally, which you can't do in a regular board meeting.
Mm-hmm.
It's more formal. So motions in a committee, for example, don't need a second.
Okay. You can just make it and
you can make a motion. I move we do so and so, and then the discussion follows
okay.
immediately. Debate in a committee is unlimited. You can speak more than twice, depending on what you're working on.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody can speak as often as they can get recognized.
Okay.
So committees sometimes go on.
Right.
But the fact is, they're working on just one thing, and it's not as difficult as a board meeting when you have to go from topic to topic. A committee can change its mind as often as it wants to before the report is made. They can reconsider a motion that's been passed, for example. If the majority of the people that voted, you know, the prevailing side is mm-hmm. all there, it just takes a majority vote to change.
So, okay.
But if the majority, the prevailing side is not there, it requires a two-thirds
mm-hmm.
vote. The committee can make any recommendation to the organization about the subject referred to it, any recommendation they wish, provided the committee as a whole agrees.
Right.
The majority has voted this and this and this. So when we have committee meetings, our committees make recommendations to the boards, and some of them result in motions that need to be made by the board,
mm-hmm.
but the committee's done all the work to get it researched. An interesting thing is a committee keeps records of its own meetings for its own use. And once they've reached their goal, suppose the party has been done,
mm-hmm.
all those records are destroyed.
Really?
They aren't kept like board meeting records.
Why aren't they kept?
Because the work is done.
Okay.
And it isn't necessary for everybody in the country to know how the committee reached their conclusions, because they're presenting a report as to how they reached their conclusions.
Okay. I thought maybe they, certain committees might if that ever comes up again, like planning a party, hypothetically,
yeah.
Hey, let's go back to our notes from 2 years ago when we planned this party and see how we did that.
Just the results would be
yeah.
important
and okay.
getting to it.
Interesting.
Now, and some of the standing committees, like finance, for example,
right.
they will keep that record.
Okay.
But it goes into the report to the board. Is it necessary for it to be separate? Not always, not usually.
Okay.
Sometimes a committee has the power to act.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if we'll go back to the party, and the committee is in charge of the party, so they have the power to act to get it done.
Mm-hmm.
And it's said so by the assembly, and the assembly's bound by whatever they do.
Right. Okay.
Simple. Well, sometimes not so simple. But a committee must do certain things. They have to follow the instructions of the assembly, of the board.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a new committee, they have to meet as soon as possible after the appointment to organize and get done the work that needs to be done. And at every meeting, they need to have a quorum. Otherwise, it can't act.
Right. Okay.
They have to report to the assembly at the time specified. Okay, you guys have got a month to research this and get a report back to us, and this is the date you're going to report. So that's what they have to do. Our committees here, the board committees, make monthly or bi-monthly reports,
right,
depending on how often they meet. If a committee recommends an action, they need to submit resolution to carry out its recommendation. Now, here in the village, the resolutions are separate, but they may have been recommended by
right,
a committee.
Right.
And so the committee's work is there in a report before the before the vote. So a committee can report, in some cases, they can report orally mm-hmm. on the work that's done, and you find this with clubs and smaller groups.
Okay. All right. We're just about out of time.
Okay.
So I know you got it. I'll let you wrap it up. But it looks like a committee report. Okay. Time to wrap up.
Okay.
Wrapping up.
Okay. Okay. Well, that's pretty much it. The committee reports back to the board, and the committee can only make recommendations
right. yeah.
unless they are told that they are an action committee.
All right. Very good. Thank you very much, Joan. And of course, if you want to learn more about this, you can join the Roberts Rules Study Club. And their next meeting is Saturday, not this Saturday, a week from Saturday on the 13th, 9 o'clock in the Towers Key Club room. We'll be right back.
The Laguna Hills Lodge is very proud to have been awarded the TripAdvisor Award of Excellence for the last 5 years. Discover this family-friendly boutique hotel and enjoy our crystal-clear pool and spa, beautiful gardens, and convenient location. Our designer-upgraded rooms feature luxury comforts of much higher-priced hotel chains and include free continental breakfast, parking, Wi-Fi, and more. We match the lowest price you can find online. Ask about our Laguna Woods special offer.
Welcome back. Well, with me right now is somebody I think if you've been watching for a while, you may know, and that is Bill Crawford, who's the owner of the Laguna Hills Lodge, and then somebody that I'd like to welcome on for the first time, Beth Scott, who is the owner of Chick-fil-A, and of course, you folks
are neighbors.
You sell a driveway, so thank you very much for both of you coming. Thank you. We'll get to your sandwiches
sure.
in just a moment. Bill? Tell us about the history of Laguna Hills Lodge. It's how many years now? 50 years?
A little over 50 years.
Yeah.
It's kind of a fun connection with Laguna Woods, mm-hmm. aka Leisure World. In 1968, 20 retirees from Laguna Woods each invested $5,000 and they built Laguna Hills Lodge. And they did that because when family came to visit, there was no place to stay.
Yeah,
this area
yeah.
was, as you know, orange groves
yeah.
and some bean fields. So families would have to drive to Laguna Beach to find a hotel. So these retirees invested in the lodge and they picked a site mm-hmm. just outside, you know, across the street from Laguna Woods and close to the 5 freeway. And so ever since that time, we've been sort of the spare bedroom for Laguna Woods.
And how long have you had it in your family?
Since 1972.
Okay.
So what happened is, as you might guess, 20 individuals, $5,000 each. After a few years, they don't all agree on how things should
yes.
work out. So they decided to part ways. And at that time, 72, 4 years later, they offered it for sale. And so my family bought it at that point. So we've owned it ever since. We had Hyatt manage it for a few years. And then after that, we took over ourselves.
Okay. And that happens sometimes
it
with
does.
different hotels. And they'll have a third party come in and do something with them, like the Marriott autograph and things
yeah.
like that. But it's good that you folks are doing this because it's like your family, your home base is here, you know the community well.
Yeah, we really have a connection with the community, and it is a family. We have, you know, our personal families, we have our business families, and so
yeah.
actually this year is the 40th anniversary for our housekeeping manager, who has been at the hotel for 40 years. And she met her husband at the lodge, and he's been the maintenance manager for 39 years.
Wow.
So your point is well taken, Katie. Yeah. It's a family.
And one of the things that you're noted for, besides great service and the rooms, but the gardens there are beautiful.
Thank you, yeah. Oh, my dad gets credit for that. So we have 350 varieties of roses.
Wow.
450 rose bushes around the perimeter of the property. 80 bougainvilleas and clematis. So it's not sterile, chain-like at all. It's very family, Mediterranean looking, and it really works well. A lot of our guests come out in April and May, and flowers all over the place.
Yeah, it's really beautiful. Now, we'll talk about your specials in just a moment. I want to welcome again Beth here. And you've been, you and your family have been the owners, the franchise owners of Chick-fil-A since 2015, right?
Yes.
And I was surprised because we talked about, I remember when it first opened, we did a segment over there with the couple that owned it before you, and they moved back to Texas. And I was surprised it's been there 7 years.
Yeah, it's
So how did you come across getting into the franchise business?
Well, I mean, similar to the lodge, we're very family oriented. So you might have heard about Chick-fil-A being family owned.
Right.
Then each franchise having someone in the local community. And I've owned a business before and just love serving the community and the people. And a good friend of mine owned a Chick-fil-A, so I was in his restaurant slinging fries and really learning about what it took, and just loved every component of it.
Yeah, both of you, you're in the hospitality service business. They are not easy businesses to operate because you have to stay at a certain level. And we know that, especially now with online opinions and reviews and things like that. It's even harder than it was years ago. So when you get into those two kinds of businesses, to maintain that is really a challenge, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah. It is.
So easier said than done. So in the hotel business, we look at TripAdvisor as an indicator, and so I use that as a gauge and read those reviews all the time, pay attention to what the folks say. And we're happy to say that we've won the TripAdvisor Award of Excellence each year for the last 8 years. And one out of 10 hotels gets that each year, so we feel really good. And that's why we like Chick-fil-A too, because they're so focused on service and they're a good neighbor.
Right.
We send customers back and forth all the time because we know we can trust them to do a good job.
Yeah, we do really look at it as a people business, not a chicken business.
Yeah.
So I think that's a big part of it, is just the training and that culture that we start with our team.
Right.
So that it emanates out to the guests.
And you folks are open, you open at 6?
We open at 6:30 a.m. We have breakfast, which a lot of people don't even realize.
And, you know, it's interesting. When Chick-fil-A first came to the area, which is probably about 12 years ago, you know, you heard about them, but they weren't in Southern California yet. And people heard of them. Boy, they got the breakfast chicken biscuit sandwiches, which around here, at first you're going, what? Which is very common. Certainly in the South.
Sure.
Around the rest of the country.
Yeah. I have to admit, my favorite is our chicken burrito because I am a West Coast girl.
Yeah.
But we hand make the biscuits. So
if
you haven't tried them, you should. They're really good.
And you also, the chicken that you get in is fresh. You do everything
there. All our produce is fresh. We hand bread our chicken. We hand squeeze the lemonade. So it's the service and that quality, even though we are in the fast food industry, that we want to make sure it's the best quality we can give.
And we also want to mention that you folks are closed on Sundays.
Correct.
Okay.
That is a blessing.
Yeah, so let everyone know that, you know, if you go by Sunday. In fact, they were talking about that for the Super Bowl at Mercedes Stadium, that the Chick-fil-A there, somebody goes, what do? They just close? And they go, well, someone came on, they go, no, actually what they do for the games that are on Sunday, they transform it to like a pop-up type place, a different thing. But even there, for the Super Bowl,
we were still closed on Sundays.
Closed. Yes. All right. You and Holly Lobby.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Yeah. Now, you're not closed on Sundays.
We're open 24/7.
You're open 24/7. And you have a great deal here for the folks?
We do. For Laguna Woods, right now through May 23rd, 35% off, which is really good for our garden mm-hmm. rooms. And we only offer the garden rooms to Laguna Woods because that's our upscale room.
Oh, great.
We have two types, standard and garden, and all those rooms have been remodeled in the last 2 years. So it's a really nice, attractive offer.
Very good.
Yeah.
Now, as far as people coming over there and just walking the gardens, they're welcome to do that, right?
Oh, sure.
Because it is beautiful. I really tell people, you know, go by there and just stroll through there. But you know what? Then you, in your mind, you think, hey, I got some family or friends visiting. This is where they can go. You don't want them staying at your place. You don't want that. But have them stay there and then walk across and have some chicken sandwiches.
Yeah.
All right.
And we have a senior beverage that we offer. So this is all the time, Monday through Saturday. So anytime anyone comes in and purchases something, they get a free soda, coffee, or tea.
Okay.
So just to encourage, you know, we want you to come by and check us out.
All right, very good. Have the lemonade, though.
Yes,
I mean,
that's true.
Delicious.
Fresh squeezed lemonade.
Yeah, that's the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have a map here. I think a lot of people know where both of you are at. Now, you're technically on Paseo de Valencia, so you're sort of behind the Laguna Hills City Hall, and of course Chick-fil-A is right there on El Toro Road.
Right.
But I think most people know where you folks are. You've been around quite a while.
We have.
All right. Good to see you. Hope
nice
to see you again.
Right.
And
yes,
thank you much.
Thank you.
After the show, I'll be diving into those sandwiches.
Please
okay.
do.
Thank you.
Thanks.
We'll be right back. Coming up on Friday, a really good movie. I enjoy this very much. Ralph Breaks the Internet. This is the sequel to Wreck-It Ralph. And in this way, video game bad guy Ralph and his fellow misfit Vanellope must risk it all by traveling to the World Wide Web in search of a replacement park to save Vanellope's video game Sugar Rush. In their way over, Ralph and Vanellope rely on citizens of the internet, the netizens, who help navigate their way, including an entrepreneur named Yes, who is the head algorithm in the heart and soul of the trend-making site BuzzTube. What I really liked about this, there's a scene where they go into the Disney play area, and all the princesses are there and Disney characters, and they have them doing just different things that you wouldn't expect, and it's very well done. I really enjoyed this movie a lot.
Good.
So Ralph Breaks the Internet is coming up on Friday, 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. And in truth, as I was saying earlier, Avengers Endgame really did break the internet yesterday by pre-sales.
Oh, did it really? So, you knew it would.
Yeah, so there you go. It
very
does
exciting.
Happen.
Very exciting. Very exciting. Okay, on Monday we have a movie called Creed, and that is under the, you know, the tutelage of Rocky Balboa.
Yep.
Is that the right word? Heavyweight contender Adonis Creed faces off against Victor Drago, son of Ivan Drago. Years after Adonis Creed made a name for himself under Rocky Balboa's mentorship, the young boxer becomes the heavyweight champion of the world. While life is good with that victory and his marriage to Bianca, trouble comes to Philadelphia when Ivan Drago, the Russian boxer who killed Adonis's father, Apollo, arrives with his son. So drama, lots of boxing, sport, you know, all that kind of thing. So that will be on Monday at 2 and 6 p.m. So watch that.
Yeah, looks good.
Yeah, we have one announcement I'd like to make. So in April, on April 18th through the 28th, Disney on Ice is coming, and it's going to be the World of Enchantment, mm-hmm. and it's from Wheels to Waves and Icy Wonderlands to Infinity and Beyond. Disney on Ice is World of Enchantment, and it's going to be at the Long Beach Arena on Thursday, April 18th through Sunday, April 21st, and the ticket prices start at $20, but
here on our station, if you email us to Laguna Woods Village TV at gmail.com, we will give you a family of four. So you guys can take your children, your grandchildren, as long as you have four people, we're gonna give you four free tickets to go, and that could be for any of the dates that it's playing. So
right.
Super fun. So that's Laguna Woods Village TV at gmail.com. I forgot the TV on
right
there.
And it's got to be the first people.
It's got to be the first person.
Yeah.
So we've got two sets of four. All right. So I wanted to let you know that.
Very good. Yeah, it's Disney
fun.
On Ice.
Looks
used
good.
To go to that. A lot of fun.
Yeah.
Really good.
Yeah.
All right. Our weather today and tomorrow, we could see a little bit of drizzle. It shouldn't be too much at all, but it is in the forecast. So mostly cloudy to maybe a little bit of sun might peek in here and there, but there is a chance of light drizzle today and tomorrow. It shouldn't be much at all. Although we did, our house got about, 0.7 of an inch, 0.07, so almost a tenth of an inch yesterday. And then things will begin to clear up on Saturday afternoon. And look at the rise in temperatures Sunday and Monday. Tuesday as well, we're going to be in the mid-80s. Around Orange County today, everything is pretty much in the 60s. And then if you go out to Palm Springs, they're about 79 today. And Big Bear, I mentioned earlier, 50 today. By Sunday and Monday, they're going to be in the low 70s. So
snow's
quite
going to be gone quick.
I mean, that's summertime heat up there in the mountains. So really nice. A little bit of wind will be associated over the weekend as well with that high pressure. As we had the last couple weekends, we get that warmth and come in a little bit of wind, not too much, but the pollen.
I know. I keep seeing those bushes getting taller and taller, and I just know I'm going to have a problem. But
yeah, it's like we go outside, and everything is like our cars are coated in like this yellow pollen.
Oh,
and
I
all,
still
so.
Have those butterflies in the front of my car. Yeah. And I have my car washed.
All right.
Now we'll watch out for them. Anyway, have a great day in the village, and we will see you tomorrow.
Bye bye. Yeah, go on.